크리스탈. 1 second. Okay, let's get a start. This is a good year. This is actually first year. For many years, you guys probably know. For many years, there has been no heavy snow. I've been waiting for snowfall because normally around this time of SB2, we will get a big snow. You get a day off. And we'll figure out how feels a gap. First of all, I have no snow. So we'll continue. So today, I'll talk about second part of the what I call the essentials of neuron coding. And the last time, Monday, we talked about the concept of receptor field. And today, we'll talk about the quantitative analysis of neuron firing. Okay. So the neuron in the brain, as we talk about in other instances in this class, the information transmitted from one neuron to another, from one neuron structure to another, is by means of action potential. Okay, action potential, we also call them spikes, because we often have a trend of them, a sequence of them, we call it spectrum. So spike, action potential, sometimes people call it discharge, the same thing. Okay, spike is the name everyone uses now. Okay. So today we're going to talk about the means by which nervous system encode information by sequence of action potentials or spectrums. Okay, and we have quite a bit of cover, so I'll try to finish it today. Now, you have never seen a single spike experimentally. Most of you have not. And the experiment we did last week with the frog nerve, as I explained in the prelab, was component action potential. So if you were get a chance to record real single action potential, here's how the researchers record from them. Now the most common way is to use a microelectrode to insert into the cell body here. And then you have signal like this, this transmembrane potential you have learned. And then when it rises to the threshold, past threshold, you have action potential, something like this. Now, this kind of recording is called intracellular recording because you have insert into a cell body and then you can record from the both membrane potential, we call it EPSP, IPSP, and a spike. But this is very hard. This is as hard as if I give you a hook to get a fish in a big reservoir. I told you there are a couple of small fishes down there. Go to catch it. Without knowing where it is, you go blindly. Hopefully, you know, some point you get that fish. But this is intracellular recording. This is very hard. Another slightly easier is what I call extracellular recording. You place the electrode in the vicinity of this cell body, and you pick up a differentiation between voltage here, field or potential here, and a reference ground. Then you will get something like this. All right. Now, you notice that there's no bumps, no details of it now. That's because we took the fact that we talked about in SB2 lab, that action potential has an all along property. So each action potential now, instead of drawing the whole waveform, I can just draw the line over here, this action potential. Now, you can also record from axon, and it is also very difficult. But essentially, there are two kinds of recordings that you run into. It's called extracellular recording, record outside the cell, and intracellular recording inside the cell. Okay, and now there are two ways you can conduct experiment. You can conduct experiment in the intact brain, we call in vivo recording, this learning, and or you can conduct this in isolated neurons or slice of brain tissues, we call it in vitro. Okay, now what does action potential look like? And this is not real. This is, you know, illustration from a textbook. So here's an example of a real action potential from a monkey brain. So this is as real as it gets too. Okay, it's recorded from my laboratory, and I did not put in your handout because it's data. That's in our textbook. So what you have here, what we did here is that we have a metal electrode, tungsten electrode, insert in the brain for marmoset monkeys in the auditory cortex. We are close enough to a cell. Of course, we cannot see what are cell bodies. We're just close enough. This is like very much like fishing, ice fishing. I don't know how many of you know this. For those of you who come from the Middle West, Minnesota, or things, you know, that's ice fishing. You go there through a hole, you put it in here, deep until you get a bite, right? That's it. The bites now is action potential. So you see this whole string of action potentials. If I were to enlarge this, you would see that a bipolar waveform that you are familiar with from textbook, right? This action potential, okay. So what is this was response to? So when we recorded this, I actually recorded this for graduate student many years ago, that we're playing a song, like a tone, ooh, 5 seconds, because this is 5 seconds long. Then neurons are firing. Okay, so if you assume animal like us hear the tone by me through their auditory cortex, then the neuron must convey that information. Okay, and today we're going to talk about the methods by which neurons' information coding capacity can be measured and modeled mathematically. So if you look at how people actually get the action potential data, you know, the raw data. One would record with extracellular recording electrode, something like this. You have a spike on top of slow waveforms. These are the basically average potential in your brain. When your brain when sitting here, there's fluctuations all the time. This is not the artifact that you saw in SBE2 Live last week, right? So that's the real artifact. This is a real signal in the brain. Now, to extract action potential, one way you do it first, you can filter data. You can do a high-pass filter, you get rid of the low, slowly changing waveform, you have this, okay? Then you do something called temporal matching. This is action potential expanded, okay? And each of them, you can match them to the pattern, then you can extract action potential. So once you extract one action potential, one spike, then you can replace this and replot this by either one line, one dot. What matters, only thing matters now is the time of occurrence, because it's all along. Okay, and this sequence representing action potential here is what we call the spike trend. So all the analysis I will talk from here forward is based on spike trend. We no longer look at action potential as a raw analog signal now. So essentially, this is changing from an analog signal to a digital signal. As we'll talk about in SBE2 Live, I deal with you guys that this is nature's creation of digital system. Long before engineers in modern days create a digital system that you use every day now, right? This happened long ago in the brain. The brain used a digital signal to convey this, okay? And how do we analyze this? So for the remaining most of the time, so we're going to talk about it. Now, if I give you this action potential, how do we analyze, how do we quantify this? One of the very important methods for biomedical engineering student to know, to keep in mind, whenever you deal with biology, the first question you should always come up in your mind is how do I quantify it? Okay. Without a quantification, you are nothing. Okay. Any phenomena biologically has to be quantified. And better yet, if you can build a model, that's another level. But at least you need to be able to quantify. So today we'll discuss how to quantify action potential. Okay. And this assuming no prior knowledge of whatever I have learned. But we can learn from here, based on here forward, okay? Now, the simplest way to quantify action potential trend is to calculate something called discharge rate, okay? Because action potentials encode information in the brain. It's essentially the carrier of information in the brain. Then the quantification will come up. There are three ways we'll talk about here. Describe what information that carrier carries. Okay, so let me just give you a little bit of data, then we'll start working on this. Suppose we do the following experiment, just like one I showed you earlier. We put an electrode in the brain, in a part of the brain that responds to sound. Okay, we call it auditory brain. And we record action potentials, and then play a sound once. Let's say half second, boo. then you would have a string of action potentials I showed you earlier in the slides. And then after all the signal processing, you would extract the timing of each action potential. You plot here, each of them by a dot. Okay, it's dot. This is once. Now, action potential spectrum is not a deterministic process. It's a stochastic process. I think most of you may have heard about this term, right? So you learn or learn probability course, right? Probability course, you should know the definition of a random variable. A random variable is described by probability density function. Then if you add the time variable to that random variable, then that becomes a stochastic process. Okay. This is a quick one sentence summary. What do we mean by stochastic process? Just like temperature here. If I put thermometer here, doesn't move here. I record, you know, take sample 100 times. You know the temperature in this particular spot is a random variable. Then you can plot the distribution of this. However, if I record it over a long time, 24 hours, then that distribution would change because when all of you sitting here, the temperature probably rise, when all of you gone or drop, so far so on. Then if you plot that process, it's a random variable at a fixed time, but that random variable vary over time, then that process is called a stochastic process. Okay, stochastic process, in short, is a random variable with time as a variable. Okay, so action potential trend, one of them is stochastic process. Now, stochastic process, just like a random variable, when I say I have a random variable in my hand, I cannot give you one, right? Because every random variable, you just like you toss dice, every time it's just one instance of random variable. The way you describe random variable is by its probability density function, right? You probably all know this. A random variable can only be described by its probability density function or distributed function, if you so will. But not by variables, not by one thing. One thing is just one instance. If it's a deterministic variable, then you see this is it. Okay. Now, stochastic process is the same thing. If we say a neuron discharged in response to 500 millisecond tone, it's a stochastic process every time it's stimulated here. You give 500 millisecond, you get this spectrum. If we repeat here, you get another one. Repeat, repeat. So in this is real data. Repeat 50 times. So keep this in mind. So now we have a same neuron. The neuron is not doing anything different every time. We have electron next to neuron, to the neuron's cell body. We record action potential. We play identical sound. Boo, you got action potential. Boo, boo, boo. But every time it's different because it's a stochastic process. Okay. So this is what we have. So we plot this. This is a number of repetitions. Okay. And in nervous system, when neuroscientists study neuron, they have to repeat this, use it many times, because if you just get one sequence, that's just one realization of underlying stochastic process. That doesn't tell you anything. So this is analysis, this is kind of data that lead us to build that equivalent of probability density function for stochastic process. That's what I'll get to by the end of this lecture. Okay? Now, this plot is commonly referred to as a dot raster. Dot refers to each action potential. Okay. This is the base of many of analysis we go from here. Now, first thing you notice here, so if I told you, so say, tell me how you describe this neuron's response to tone. Okay. You will notice that this neuron has, for the 500 millisecond duration, there is a fixed number of dots, a number of spikes. Okay. So the simple thing for you to quantify here is to calculate the average number of spikes per unit of time. Then we call it discharge rate. Right? You calculate within 500 milliseconds how many dots here. Of course, there are 50 trials, you sum them average. So you have average number of dots within half second. Suppose you have 20. If you have 20 spikes per half second, then if you normalize to the rate of a second, what is that? That's a 40 spike per second. So discharge rate for this neuron would be 40 spike per second. Okay. Now, this is a very useful measure, very simple, simplest measure. So now suppose I make that sound I just gave louder. Boop! what can happen? Neuron going to fire more. So you might do the same calculation, you'll get 100 spikes per second, so far so on. That's the first measure called discharge rate. Okay, but that's not enough, because someone say, well, look, this neuron fires more at the beginning because there are more dots here, and gradually less fear and fear. Okay, how do we describe that? That's probably what we call temporal discharge pattern. That's the neuron are not, it is stochastic process, but it is not a stationary stochastic process. Okay, they fire more at the beginning, fire less. This is a property, is very common. So how do we describe this? So we describe this by calculating something we call post-stimulus histogram. Okay, so I'm going to work on this, or TA can work on this later on, how you compute it here. So I'm going to run through my basic slides. If you have time, I'll come back to derive this to you. So this is how you compute it here. This is a computer from here. It's very straightforward. So the way you compute it here is that first, this time is continuous. You bin this time into discrete bins. For example, let's say 10 milliseconds. I make small bins every 10 milliseconds from 0 to 10, 10 to 20, 20 to 30, so far so on. Okay? You make the access discrete. Then you count within the bin across all the trials how many spike, or calculate average discharge rate within that bin. Then you plot it is here. This firing rate. Now this firing rate now is only over that small bin. Right? Earlier, when I said discharge rate of the whole thing, that's firing rate over the entire thing. But if you do the same calculation, but only over a bin width here, you get this plot number for your run. Because you can sort of feel here, there's a lot of few spike here. And there's got to be a lot of spike here. That's why this bin is higher. So when we plotted this, and you can notice here, this is discrete, right? That's its bin size. And this tell you very intuitively, visually, this neuron fires after some delay, it's about 20 milliseconds, and fire most. And gradually, as time goes by, just fear and fear. And that's tell you a temporal discharge pattern. Okay. So what I like you to do is, after come back, I might have a revisit here, is that I'd like you understand both of this and be able to compute it by hand. Yes?
I'm just a little confused about what presentation number means. The y-axis of the
potential number in this case means that when I collect the action potential trend, I collect 50 times. So it's 50 repetition.
Well, each time you collected it, there was a fire.
Yeah, each time I repeat the process 50 times.
Yeah.
I can do 10 times, I can do 20 times, I can do 100 times. 50 trial repetition is the arbitrary number here. Is that clear? So each line here is action potential trend. There are 15 lines here in parallel. They were collected on the identical situation. Okay, good question. Is that clear? Because you always do at least more than once. If you just do once, you can't do any average. You have to use a large number of them. Okay, otherwise you have no average. Okay, and how many? That's a statistical question. So here we say 50 times. Yeah. So what I'd like you to do, yes?
So how long is the sound?
How long is the sound? In this case, it's 500 milliseconds.
So there's a sound going through all of that.
That's right.
Okay.
Yeah. But that's just a general case. It does not need to be. This case, I think the experiment were collected when the sound play 500 milliseconds. What's the other examples with it? So, good. Any other questions? Okay. So what I'd like you to do is being able to compute this by hand. It's very simple. And for example, I'll give you, maybe in the homework or exam, I'll give you action potential trends. And you should be able to plot this to get on scene, okay? So we'll come back to this. Now this is two simplest way to compute the firing rate and the temporal discharge pattern by means of post-stimulus histogram, PSTH, okay? Now in general, this is two of the four ways in the neuroscience literature, experimental neurobiologists calculate the firing of a neuron, a sensory neuron. We talk about mean firing rate or average discharge rate, it's the same thing. Discharge firing, this is two words people use interchangeably. The units of this is spike per second. And the second is a post-stimulus histogram we'll talk about. Third and fourth we're going to cover, this is called period histogram and inter-spike interval histogram. Each of them with increasingly complexity and information. Okay, we'll revisit his slides later on. Okay, so Why people calculate mean firing rate, even though that seems to be simple, you overlook many details, because often this is a good indication what a neuron is doing. For example, this is a neuron in visual cortex, okay? And when the bars are moving this orientation, they have this many spikes. This many spikes, then when bar move this direction, there's no spike. You can see this, but how do you quantify it? Well, if you extract spikes, compute average firing rate during this stimulus duration, you plot it here. This should be firing rate. They use F hertz, but it's discharge spikes per second. And this is the orientation angle. Zero is normalized to here. What you can see from this experiment is that firing rate is the highest at 0 degree and lower on the east side. What does it tell you? It tells you immediately this neuron is most sensitive to this orientation. Now, if this curve gives you flight, it's a flight. That means the neuron is not sensitive. So firing rate can be used in many instances. This is one of the most famous pictures because the scientists who collected is called David Hubel, who won the Nobel Prize in medicine with his colleague Thompson Wiesel in 1980. And they started career here at Johns Hopkins School of Medicine in the Weimar Institute decades ago. Okay, so when Dr. Connor gave you a lecture on visual system, you will see a picture like this again. This is a classic work. Okay, now so the mean firing rate is computed by this formula: number of spikes within time window divided by length of time window. Now, of course, if you have a multiple repetition, if you collect number of spikes with multiple repetition, you have a divided number of repetition. Okay, that's the basic formula. Okay, now just as I said here, if n trials were made, you use the formula. Okay, it's a pretty straightforward. Now and then post stimulus histogram. There's one thing I need to say is that the example I gave you earlier, I say you have to bin the axis, right? You have to make the axis to the bin so that it can compute within a window. The number I give you is 10 milliseconds. That's arbitrary. How do you choose this? Well, here is an example showing you if you start with spectrum here and you compute post-stimulus histogram using different beam width, what you got? If beam width is wide, you got something like this. If it's smaller, you get something more smooth. But you can take this one, you can do the filter, you can do all kinds of things to smooth this out. But bottom line here, when you compute that temporal pattern by PSD histogram, you have to specify the beam width. And that's primed to determine how smooth this curve you get. Now, what is the best number? Well, it's no best number. It depends what you want to see. If you want to see a lot of details, you make beam width small. But if your beam width is so small, eventually you get this. You see no pattern. Okay. This is very straightforward. Now, then that we talk about two main ways to measure. The third way to measure is here. So when I showed you action potential like this one, there's no structure of this. It looks at random. In this case, actually, it's random. Okay, but there are a lot of cases where action potential, when neurons respond to periodic signal like tone, the one I just made, ooh, right? You know, it's pure tone is sinusoidal. It's just periodic. When neuron respond to tone like this, it would have periodic firing in its action potential. So action potential as time sinks may have periodicity in this. Okay. Now in this case, that periodicity in action potential spectrum reflects the stimulus parameter. So therefore, one needs to quantify this. How do we quantify this here? So this phenomenon is illustrated by the example here. And here is a recording from auditory nerve, the nerve right behind the ear. I'll discuss this in a few weeks when I give a lecture on auditory system. So when researchers present a tone, this is a 15 millisecond tone, boop, very short. Okay? And as you know, if you expand this tone, the tone 768 hertz is periodic. Okay, tone's period. Yes?
This is a tone, it's only being played when the black bar is there. It's
that's right. Many, many times. Not kind of just within here. This is 15 minutes. This is a duration, 15 milliseconds. Pulse, repeat. So that repetition we said earlier could come from here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, so far, so on. Okay. This just is that a good question? So we expand it here. We have a sinusoidal here. And this is action potential, real action potential. Expand here, you can see here. Okay. Now, if you just look at here, you cannot tell whether it really is periodic or not. Okay. It is periodic actually, but you cannot tell. The way you analyze here is the following. If you assume there's a periodicity there, you want to analyze this because you use the periodic signal to drive this. So we do this calculation. This is a calculation leading to a period histogram, a very useful measure for neuron firing. So here's what we do. So now we pick up a multiple number of periods or cycles. Here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. We pick up 6. It's arbitrary. You need to pick up at least 2 or more than 1. So for you see things repeat. So we pick up 6 here. So this with 6 here, then the next 6, the next 6. And each of them, we take the neuron signal plot here, here, here. Okay? So in a way, we created another number of repetitions within the duration. And then, of course, each of the spikes can be represented by a dot, because only timing matters. So this generated this dot, this generated this dot. So now you have this. I want to plot 3. You can plot 50 or 100 of them. This becomes the dot raster I talked about very earlier. Okay. Once you have that, you can use the same methods I said earlier to compute the period post-stimulus histogram all over here. Then you will have this. Now, this is time. This is the firing rate per time the beam width. There's a beam width here. Okay. So what you see here now is that neuron firing goes up and down periodically. And the distance between two peaks is 1.3 milliseconds, which is exactly period here. If you 1 divide 768, you get this. So then what I mean now here is that this period histogram shows this neuron, in response to that period tone, respond periodically, exact period of this.
Are the other periodic components of the firing rate something like the harmonics of that?
No, there's no harmonic here.
But the other frequency components are random?
There's no other frequency component. There's only one frequency component, that is second 6A.
The neuron firing, because it's clearly not a perfect...
No, it's not perfect. If you do FFT, you can get it, but by and large, the dominant periodicity is this frequency. There is a little bit sideband, but for now, just focus on this period for now, and until we look at the spectrum of this. Okay. So now, one of the things we should see, this phenomenon is called phase locking. This is an exactly engineered term. You might have seen this in your linear system analysis, phase locking. Okay. And one of the things about phase locking here is that when neuron fire this periodically, this neuron did not fire every cycle. You notice here, right? Not every cycle. Here is every cycle here, but once more. But whenever it fires at the exact phase of that cycle. Therefore, you can get it here. Now, if the neuron fire randomly, what do you get from here? You get a flight. So if that neuron doesn't fire in relation, fixed relation to the cycle, you get a flag here. If a neuron fires perfectly every time, for example, at the peak of this or trough of this, every time just perfectly, what do you got from here? You got a very discrete line here. The fact that you have this width indicates that even this is phase locking, it's not accurate enough. There's jittering. Now, how to quantify this? So remember, I told you earlier, everything you have quantified. I give you I just made a statement without a justification, quantification. I say this is a periodic. Now, this is a nearly perfect case. But what if you have something like this? Would you call it periodic? Well, you need quantification. How to quantify this? So how to quantify this firing to determine to what extent this neuron firing is periodic. So another example we can see is the following. If you do an experiment on a skin, I just jump to another system. If I record from nerve here, then apply a probe in my fingertip, but apply sinusoidal vibration here, just like here. Okay? Then the neuron in here would fire like this. And this is many repetitions. And of course, you can calculate the period histogram. I just did it for you. Another way to describe here is calculate something we call inter-spike interval histogram. If you calculate periodic histogram using one period, we get it here. Now, this one we calculate here, we use a 6 period. But if you just look at one period, it looks like this. You cannot tell. So here is periodic histogram calculated only one period. Had they calculated another period, then you see another peak here. Okay. Now, another way to calculate, describe the relationship is by calculating what we call inter-spike interval histogram. This is a fourth measure. We start with talk about mean firing rate, post-symmetry histogram, periodic histogram, the inter-spike interval histogram. Right. Now, how do we calculate it here? Since you have spike here, the inter-spike interval histogram is the time distance, the distance between two spikes. Okay. So if there's all spikes here, the first interval is between these two spikes. Next, between here, between here, between here. Okay. So you have all of intervals. Then you can compute the histogram that's shown here. Okay. And I'll work on the blackboard later on to show you how to calculate it. But in situ, you think about this. I give you 100 spikes. How many intervals? 99. All right. The 99 intervals, let's say they can range from 1 millisecond to 20 milliseconds. There are many, many in between. And you use that data to generate the histogram. This is here. The interval distribution, that is a percentage of the intervals in this. So this is inter-spike histogram come out of the data. Now let's take a closer look on here. Why we have a peak here at 100 milliseconds? What does that reflect? Why we have bump here? Yes.
Isn't that the period of the stimulus?
Yes. This is a period of stimulus. That's about 100 milliseconds. That's referred here. Good. Now, of course, you know, if this neuron responds to a different frequency, this will change. Then what about this? Why have I peak here? What is that?
Noise.
What's that?
Noise. Like
not entirely. There's part of that is random. For example, if you look spike here, when there is no stimulation, there's a spike here. This is called spontaneous spike. Okay. But this don't necessarily contribute here. Remember, this is the interval. And this is a very short interval. Yes.
Bursting?
Yes, it could be bursting. So because this is very short, a few milliseconds, that means that whenever a neuron fire, they fire 2, 3 spikes, 4, 5 spikes together. That's generally a very short interval. So it's not necessarily background unless it's bursting. Because background, if you look at interval here, the interval is quite long. Right? So this indicates the neuron fires a couple of spikes in vicinity. You have this. So inter-spike interval is the most accurate description of spike trend. You can go from here to here. So what I expect to know is, I'm going to run through here, and the TA will help you digest that. If I show you interval histogram, you'll be able to tell what a general pattern of spike trend is, and vice versa. Okay, it's all here. Okay. Then what we do now is that after all those four levels of analysis, we see this contains most information on the spike trend. Then we're going to ask what kind of mathematical tools you can apply to quantify this. Okay. Now, if the neuron does not fire in a phase-like manner, what are you going to get from here? If you don't fire randomly, what are you going to get? Depends on how random it is. That's what I'm going to touch on. Depends on how random it is. If the neuron has no phase locking, you should not see a peak anywhere here. But you should see something like this, but with probably a different level of decay. That's what I'm going to say now. Okay? Now, the another way to think about phase locking, quantification of phase locking is finishes. Because phase locking is essentially talk about the locking to one cycle. When you have sinusoidal, you have 360 degrees, right? And you can plot this in cycle. You can plot this in a circular statistics. So that's how you calculate this. So I'm just giving these two formulas, and we're not going to prove this in this class. So this is two ways you can quantify it. That's phase locking of a neuron. One of them is calculated by this. This is based on circular statistics. And you can do this by hand reasonably easily with a calculator.
Another way is to just use the FFT to calculate the spectrum of this. And then and you can calculate synchronization index. This is quantification of phase sucking. This is energy at F0 that is equivalent to here. If you do spectral analysis, this is energy amplitude at a 0 point. And if you apply either one of these, then you can quantify phase sucking. So I'm going to get you to do this perhaps in homework. Okay, but just leave it for now. But now let me move on to more mathematical describing of this now. So I just posed that question. If I give you spectrum, and that spectrum has a particular stochastic process, how do we model this mathematically? Okay, so let me go back to the spectrum definition. So if we have spectrum like this, here's the spectrum we're working on. First spike, second spike, third, so far, so on. Okay, now some of you might have remembered the Poisson process from a statistical course. Then you can also compute this in terms of how many events or number of spike within time window. So between here, start from zero until before the point, the count is zero. And then at this time point, you got one. And then two, three, four, five. Okay. Now, how many of you have heard about the Poisson process in statistics? Good, some of you heard. So this, in that class, often teacher wants to use this, analogy of this is arrival time of a bus. So you sit in a bus station. You're sitting here. After a certain time, one bus arrive, another arrive, so far, so on. Okay. So if you're going to ask a question, at a time t, how many buses has arrived? It's part of here. The number of buses that arrive here is 3 of time t. Now, this is two ways to represent the same thing. This is interval representation. Or arrive time representation. This is called a counting process. So mathematically, these two are equivalent, absolutely equivalent. They can be proved. Okay. Now, it is much easier for us to analyze spectrum use this format, as we will appreciate in a few minutes. Okay. So, but if this process is a Poisson, if this process is a Poisson process, then this random variable, okay, its distribution function, because it's counting, so its distribution function is described here, that you can find in any mathematical probability stochastic book. Now, if we look here, the variable now is other than first point, everything else is described by interval between two events. This is called a tau. Now, if this were spike, this tau is our so-called inter-spike interval. Okay, this obey exponential distribution. That is, the probability density function is described by this. All right. So now you can see this is really convenient for us to model spike, because spike is most like this, right? So therefore, if I give you spectrum, if you can describe the density function of tau, then that's all you need. Describe the whole spectrum. Okay, this is what I'm going to do. So how do we do this? Okay, now, so for now, let's just forget this. Just focus on here. So if you get a spectrum, you can describe this distribution, then you are done. Now, this is distribution just for Poisson. Okay, but if it's a Poisson distribution, if we plot here, this is what we got. This interval distribution, tau, inter-spike interval distribution, versus Poisson distribution, is like this. So the question here, I have a question for you now, is that biologically, does this make sense? Can we use Poisson distribution to describe a real spike trend? If this is the interval distribution, can we? You guys just did the lab. The lab we discussed property of action potential, right? One of the property of action potential other than all along, what's other property? You know, what's that? No, action potential has a couple of properties. Now you guys know why I do that live with the lecture together. So remember, many of you already knew the answer. So when we talk about action potential, first thing is all along. What's the second thing? You actually did a measurement in your experiment.
They have different refractory period?
Yes, have a refractory period. If action potential has a refractory period, what does it say to you?
Because?
That's right. So, correct. That is what I was looking for. Because action potential have a referral period, the two action potential cannot be indefinitely close. Okay. This tell you the two events between these two, the tau can be indefinitely small, approach zero. And that's just not going to happen because action potential has a referral period. One is absolute, one is relative. So if I were to draw a spike interval distribution for action potential, it would be something like this, right? Because, for example, something like this, initially there is absolute referral period, and then gradually probability increase, this reflects the relative referral period, then like this. So this would be more like biologically feasible inter-spike interval distribution. Now here's the issue now. I just told you that the most nice ideal mathematical model for spectrum is exponential distribution, because this is, you can work out this very nice, very easy analytically. But then biologically it's not feasible. So how do we apply this to a biologically meaningful action potential trend? And the way to do that is to think about the interval distribution. And if we start with the interval distribution like this, now this happened to be called the gamma distribution, and with different coefficients k, and you can get a different curve here. Okay. Now let's go back to take a look at the eyesight of a real spectrum. So if you take a real spectrum, and you compute the inter-spike interval histogram, this is what you got, right? This is exactly what you expect. Here's the refractory period, and then firing rate is here, and it goes down. Now, neuron like this, doesn't this neuron have face locking? Is there face locking in this neuron? If this is the histogram, ISI, inter-spike interval histogram for neuron, can you tell if there's face locking?
I can't understand what the last thing you said.
Face locking. Yeah, face locking. Is there face locking in this neuron? Yes or no?
Can't you say it's around 10?
It could. It could. So if there was face locking, it has to be, it cannot be in the here. Because if the neurons face lock to 100 millisecond, you have peak here. For 80 millisecond, you have peak here. Now, you could have face locking embedded in here. We could not tell. Okay, we cannot tell. That's one. Now, how do we model this neuron, right? How to model it? So maybe I will take you too far now. Let me step back. Why I want to do this? So in biology, you start with experiment. Just like you drop an electron in the brain, it collects action potential. So that's the first thing you do if you're a biologist. Now, if you want to quantify that, analyze that, then you compute those one of those measures, average firing rate, so forth, so on, off of that data. That's the second step. Most time, that's where biologists stop. There's one more step. I think people like you, biomedical engineers and theoreticians, physics and mathematicians, want to take another step, that is to build a mathematical model of this process. So the exercise that I'm taking you through now is the last third one. We've started the first one, describe this, and the quantification, we talk about four measures. Now we're going through this exercise to see how do you take it from the second step to third one, that I build a mathematical model of this. Now, some of you may ask, so why you bother? Why bother to make a model? The thing is, once you can make a model, then that model can generate new predictions. Then you do not need, in the ideal situation, you don't need to do experiment. Now you have a model handling of a biological phenomena. Okay, this is a small exercise to show you philosophy and approach to this. Okay, so now, for example, we want to model this action potential trend from a real neuron, and whose histogram, interval histogram, is like this. This is not a Poisson. If it's a Poisson, it would be a lot easy. Okay. How do you do this? Well, one thing you could do, you can fit this by some formula like this, and then we try to simulate here. Okay, so here's what let me do it this way. So let me jump to this one. So here's mathematically you can simulate this. So this, you can convert this essentially into a probability density function. And as in the case of a Poisson process, for example, go back to Poisson process, we have this interval distribution that's exponential. So that means for this Poisson process, if you give me this, I can recreate the whole process. Just like I throw dice out of the distribution, I can generate one tau after another, generate tau 1, tau 2, tau 3, tau 4, all the way to tau n. That plus location of a first spike, I can create entire sequence. So that means, let me repeat one more time. If it's a Poisson process, if I give you a distribution, you can recreate this statistically identical process. Okay. Now for real neuron, it's no longer this, it's modified like a gamma. But it goes the same way. If you give me distribution, I'll be able to recreate here. As long as you can describe the distribution of intervals. And here's that distribution of intervals. But how do you generate the distribution of this? So here's some mathematics that allow you to do this. Again, we're not going to prove this, so I just tell you. So if you want to generate a random variable, there are many ways to generate random variables. The simplest way is start from a uniform distribution. If you have a uniform distribution, that's the simplest random variable between 0 and 1. And then you can use that distribution to generate many other distributions, like Poisson, like Gaussian distribution, like all other distributions, provided certain conditions are met. Okay. So this is actually an exercise I want you to go through. Why this is very useful, because then you say, well, Poisson, for example, Poisson distribution. You say, well, I go to MATLAB, I type a Poisson distribution, I get a Poisson distribution. That's actually a little bit cheating, because everything in this one actually is all boiled down to one random variable generator, which is 0 to 1 uniform. This is, takes the least assumption. And then once you have this, you can generate here. Here's the mathematics that allow you to do this. If u is a random variable of uniform distribution between 0 and 1, and f of t is the probability distribution function of a random variable tau, then omega of inverse of the f function, now this is a random variable with a probability distribution function of here. So if I take the Poisson as an example, if this is a distribution, not density, distribution function for the Poisson process, and then I generate random variable u from a uniform distribution or plug into the formula, this I got is this. So that is what here. For Poisson process, f of t is this. You can compute it here. And this function inverse of this is here. So how do we do that? So if I allow you to generate a random variable from MATLAB or somewhere, but a uniform distribution, you know, through a dice, you get a random variable between 0 and 1. You plug here, then compute the value. That becomes its correspondence, but it's in the Poisson distribution now. Okay. This is for a function, distribution function, that can be inverted. Right? But a function like this cannot be inverted. So what do you do? You need an inverted function. But if you, when you have a function that cannot be analytically inverted, how would you do? Graph. What's that? Graph it numerically. So you can do this numerically, right? So if you do numerically, then you'll be able to apply this to other one. So here's exercise I'd like you to do in the homework. So I'd like you to model and simulate a real action-potential neural train from a real neuron. Okay. And here's the process it takes. I give you spike trains. I give you a real spike train, however many spikes I give it to you. First thing you do is you compute inter-spike interval distribution of that spike train I give you, have something like this. Okay. That's a density distribution. Then the next thing you do is that you compute its distribution function. That's just integration of that. You can do it numerically. Once you do that, then you can invert that and then generate a uniform random variable from the MATLAB and use this invert function to produce the probability distribution function of this spectrum. Okay. Once you have this, the last thing you verify is this. Now you have user interval distribution to produce another spectrum. And that spectrum statistically should be identical to the one you started with. So that's the exercise I want you to take through, from data to model to simulation. So in this case, what you simulate, if you do it correctly, would be statistically identical to the one you begin with. Once you finish the loop, then I think you get an appreciation and understanding what is usefulness of this. Okay. So I know I covered quite a bit out here, and you need to digest this. So for those, I haven't finished it, don't worry. I watch the time here. I have a couple of minutes. So this is something for your friends who don't come to class, don't engage in discussion. There's no way you can get this the night before exam. Trust me, there's no way you can look at these things. You have to understand this, exercise this, do the homework, do that, I'll get you to do this. And there are a lot of details I'd love you to do. So let me summarize what I talk about here. What I talk about today is the four ways to quantify the action potential trend. I hope it will get you to homework. And then the way to simulate this. Okay. Now, what are the use of this? This is my last three slides. So why I want to do all of this? To analyze biology phenomena. So let me give you an example. I give you, last week I did a demo. I give someone a finger here, a tap here, right? So you can feel here. Now, how do I know the relationship between what I actually apply here, what I perceive as light or strong? So the experiment people do the following. So if you tap people's finger with a different level of intensity, okay, and you ask people, how do you feel? Tell me if it's 10, if you feel strong, is 1, is light, and you vary the intensity. And people normally tell you something like this. So you get like a perceived sensation intensity. So when you type more heavily, people feel, yeah, it's close to 10 or close to 1. Okay. Then you record from a neuron here while doing the same experiment. And this is skin indentation that's similar here. You record firing rate from here. Now you can compute average firing rate. You have this relationship. Now, if you have this, then you can conclude your perception is proportionally linked to the firing rate. This is the simplest example in nervous system. Yes?
That says number of impulses for the y-axis on the left.
Yeah, the impulse here is actually spikes.
Okay, so yeah. The
number of spikes?
Or the frequency of spikes.
You can, it's a number of spikes, but you can average it to spike per second. Yeah, qualitatively it's the same going direction. You can consider the firing rate too. Okay. Now, in this case, then intensity of a sensation is related to discharge rate of a sensory neuron in this case, because the two are linear. Often it's non-linear, then they get more difficult. Okay. So I'm going to stop here. If any of you have questions, I'll hang on for a few minutes.